So good morning, everyone. And to start with the event today, I would just like to say cultural heritage is a very complex and subjective term. It is not easy to define this intangible aspect of lives. However, we constantly interact with it in varied forms like monuments, food, music, landscapes, and so on. We keep exchanging roles with it. Sometimes we are molding culture, sometimes culture is molding us. And that is the interesting part about it. In 2001, UNESCO defined culture as the set of distinctive spiritual, material, intellectual, and emotional features of society or a social group that encompasses not only art and literature, but lifestyles, ways of living together, value systems, traditions, and beliefs. These features manifest with human adapting, understanding, and modifying their environment. And humans have interacted with the environment since we became an organized species. So to sum it up, the whole world right now is like a cultural landscape where humans have left their interaction footprints and their the signs where they have tried to adapt with the environment. The idea still continues, and it continues to evolve, and lately manifested in form of a global project as well, known as Nature Culture Journey, when IUCN in ECOMOS came together to bridge the gap between the two. To envisage further on, we have gathered today on the occasion of World Heritage Day, also known as International Day of Monuments and Sites, to ponder upon it. So good morning, everyone. I'm Nishant Upadhyay. I'm a conservation architect, and I run a small firm by the name of Dharatal. We do heritage conservation projects all across the country, and I'm happily the moderator of the session today. So I would like to extend a very warm welcome to the esteemed panelists right now, and our prized attendees who took time on Sunday morning to join us all for this discussion. You have my gratitude. Without further ado, I would like to invite Shiv Shekhar Shukla, IS Principal Secretary, Department of Tourism and Culture and Public Relations, Government of Madhya Pradesh, and Managing Director, Madhya Pradesh Tourism Board, to say a note of welcome for everyone. Sir, please.
Namaskar. First of all, let me welcome all the esteemed panelists who have come with us today. Despite being a Sunday, despite we all being in a deep crisis of the present pandemic situation, I'm especially grateful to Madam Sudha Murthy, Madam Rupinder Braji, Pandit Rajan Sajan Mishraji, Mr. Steve Borgia, and Mr. S.P. Ota, who have come forward and have given their consent to participate in this webinar. I welcome you all, and on this occasion of World Heritage Day, which gives us a chance to celebrate our history, to celebrate those living mementos of our present connecting with the past, I would just like to say that Madhya Pradesh, being home to one of the major archaeological heritage of the country, and we boast of having more than 818 protected sites, out of that 291 protected by ASL and 527 by State Archaeology Department. And we are also we boast of having three World Heritage Sites in the state, Sachi, Khajuraho, Bhimpetika. Two more are already in the tentative list, Ocha and Mandu, and two more further are being processed to be put in the tentative list of World Heritage Site of UNESCO, which are Satpura National Park and Bhedaghat, Jabalpur. So Madhya Pradesh being one of those rich places where culture thrives, and we have all forms of cultural heritage, whether it is through art or dance or music or monuments, sites, museums. We have all in one. One can come to Madhya Pradesh and see for themselves the kind of rich heritage we have. I would just like to set the tone for today's discussion, since all of us are very eager to listen to our esteemed panelists, who are all luminaries and they're all jewels in the cultural fabric of the nation. I would like to raise a couple of issues as an administrator, as Principal Secretary of Tourism and Culture Department, also Commissioner of Archaeology Department in the state. I would like to just raise before my panelists that this question, which bothers us very often, that how we should be making heritage conservation everybody's business rather than depending only on the government. How to involve people, how to involve corporates, how to involve everybody who is interested in the scenario, and how to improve the situation on the field. The second thing which comes to my mind is about the use of technology. How to really get hold of the latest technological innovations to create, good audio visuals and a very nice way of putting things before our young generation, who starts taking pride in the rich cultural heritage of the country and bring heritage closer to younger hearts. And of course, today in the panelists, we have all the experts of their domains, who would enlighten us how to take heritage conservation to philanthropy, to commerce, how to commercialize it. That is also a very important aspect, and Mr. Borgia will definitely enlighten us about that, how to make them viable.
Can I have the phone numbers of all the participants and emails?
And then taken together, how to take this heritage conservation from mere rhetoric to some tangible action and convert into a very good tourism property. So I would not like to take more time, because we are all here to listen to all of you from the side of Madhya Pradesh. We welcome you all the participants who have joined us today. This particular webinar is going to set the trend for the future, and we will definitely be benefited by the ideas of all the esteemed panelists. Thank you so much, Nishant. Over to you.
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot for the welcome note. Next, I would like to invite Ms. Rupinder Brar for the opening remarks. Just to introduce, Ms. Brar is working as an additional DG in Ministry of Tourism since September 2019. An officer of the 1990 batch of Indian Revenue Services, Ms. Brar has served in various capacities all over India. Ms. Brar has attended numerous trainings in India and overseas, including completing Masters in Public Administration at Lee Kuan Yew School of Public Policy. In his current stint, she's spearheading the Dekho Apna Desh initiative and also leading the working with the state governments to leverage the diverse heritage of India. Thank you, Ms. Brar. Over to you.
Thank you, Nishant, and thank you, Madhya Pradesh Tourism. And thank you to all the panelists for agreeing and accepting the invite sent by Madhya Pradesh, where we thought that, it's like celebrating a birthday. And so you want to do it on the day it is. We were half tempted that should we do it on a Monday? Should we do it on a Saturday? But then the fascination that I think all of us at all ages have to blow the candles on the day that you actually have your birthday just tempted us to bother all of you on a Sunday. So thank you so much for joining in. Now, why are we all here? And I'm going to just touch a little more on the tourism part of it, because that's where I work currently. That what truly is culture, what truly is heritage, and what truly is tourism, and how are we supposed to blend this all together? I think that's where our challenge in a country like India comes. Every time we start making, in fact, a panel, and when we were making this panel also, the biggest challenge is what all to include and what not to include. And I think that's the splendor of India. That's the splendor of a civilization which is as ancient as we are. And yet we are also a very modern country. We are a country, Sudhaji is here, Infosys, which drives not just technological, modern interventions in India, but all across the world. Silicon Valley in the US is driven by our technology. So how are we supposed to find the right balance between being the country which has the oldest living city in the form of Varanasi, and we are happy to have Pandit Rajan and Sajan Mishra who belong to Varanasi, and yet taking forward the narrative of a modern India, how to make sure the traditions are preserved, and those are not just preserved, but are actually available to be showcased to a traveler. Because not only are we looking at an inbound traveler who has no real ideas about India, is possibly going to come here for a 7 to 10 day kind of a tour, how to showcase those best elements in those 10 days to a traveler, but also to Indians themselves. Because within India, the kind of diversity that exists is phenomenally challenging, I think, for anyone to be able to say, these are those five elements that I want to see. Because every time that you touch five elements, you say, oh, I missed the other five. I think that's where we would really be benefited by discussion from all the experts in their fields, that what is it that we should be doing in a country which has close to 10,000 odd sites that truly deserve to be called heritage sites. And that is the intangible part of it, the music, the dance form, the art forms. We were talking of embroidery just before the session began. There is just so much. But how to really put it all together from the tourist point of view, considering and given the fact that most of the people these days are working, they have tight schedules, and we know they have limited times. So how to create that experience, how to create that holistic evaluation, and also how to find the right balance. And I'm sure we'll have a question for Panditji on that, on preserving the old traditions, but also still making it in a manner that is, it goes generations. And so every generation will add those few nuances of its own. So are we to preserve the classical traditions the way they were? Or are we to keep adding the layers and layers of human evolution and create new products? I think these are some of the things that we look forward to from today's session. And of course, there will be questions also, and I'm sure there'll be ponderings from people who've tuned in. And this is just one of the dialogues. I'm sure these dialogues, as Nishanti already said, she also said, that it's just a beginning of a dialogue. I think this is a dialogue that India definitely needs to do with more intensity. How to ensure community participation, how to ensure that the ancient lives with the modern, how to ensure that the evolution happens in a manner that we actually package it in a manner where anybody sitting anywhere in the world trying to choose a country to go for a holiday says, I want to go to India, and I want to go to India for these reasons. I think those are our challenges and those are our opportunities. So with those opening remarks, I'm going to pass it back to you, Nishan, and look forward to a lot of benefiting discussion as we go along.
Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot, Ms. Brad. This was really very nicely, comprehensively put. And also the panel we have today is very diverse and interesting. And since we go ahead in the panel discussion, I would like to introduce them all as well. And on behalf of the panel, I would already thank Madhya Pradesh Tourism for hosting us and giving us a platform to allow to have this kind of discussion and discourse between us. So to start with, we have Mrs. Sudha Murthy, who is the chairperson of Infosys Foundation, born in Shigaon Haveri district in North Karnataka, Dharwad. And she studied in Kannada medium school till the 10th standard and fell in love with the language. Her strong ties to the language and its people led her to establish more than 60,000 libraries in Karnataka. Mrs. Murthy, who has 9 honorary doctorate, is a prolific writer in English and Kannada. Some of her awards include the R.K. Narayan Award for Literature, the Padma Shri in 2006, the Ati Mabe Award from the Government of Karnataka for Excellence in Kannada Literature in 2011, the Lifetime Achievement by Crossword Book Award in 2018, and more recently, the Lal Bahadur Shastri National Award for Excellence in 2020. She lives by the belief that generosity of a few is hope for millions. Welcome, Sudhaji.
Namaste. It's a great pleasure that you have invited me to Madhya Pradesh, and I am a granddaughter of a history teacher and a daughter of a history teacher. So history was part of my inseparable part of my life, and Karnataka has a great connection with Madhya Pradesh, including Dhara Nagari and all those things. If you know, in the 11th, 10th, 6th, 7th, 8th century, if you read Karnataka history, we always had some connection with Madhya Pradesh.
Yeah.
So that's one of the reasons I felt we are very close. I have told.
That's brilliant. If I can just introduce the rest of the panel members as well, and then we can have a discussion together. Because we want to hear those wise words all together. Then we also have Mr. Steve Borgia. Mr. Borgia is currently the chairman and managing director of Indeco Leisure Hotels. Indeco is India Ecology, a tourism company with national interest, and also the only Indian hotel group to win the Distinguished Global Ecotourism Award. Is pioneering rural tourism in India to mend the broken backbone of Indian villages has been one of the most significant contributions to tourism and development in India. With basic education in commerce, he specialized in group dynamics and social communication from CNRS, Lyon, France. Later returned to India to do ground research in social communication for rural development. He wears several caps, but all throughout carries the Indologist one, whether the UN, Government of India, press, film, hotel, or the corporate. He has authored several books and established museums as well. Pigeon to Post, his coffee table book recording the evolution of Indian postal history, won him accolades across the globe. He's in the process of creating a world wonder, the last resort for human wonderment, and the Ecoville, a sustainable village for earth-loving people in the heart of Tamil Nadu. Welcome, Mr. Borgia. And then we have Pandit Rajan and Sajan Mishra, and recipient of Padma Bhushan Awards, the Hindu classical vocalist. They were born in Banaras and they graduated from Banaras Hindu University. And they were initially trained by their father, late Pandit Hanuman Prasad Mishra, who was a famous Sarangi player. And they got their initial training there, and that's how they got inculcated into the Banaras Gharana. They have been practicing the tradition of music with the same Gharana since 4 decades. And they have got various accolades all across the world. They have traveled different countries, have various kind of international exchanges, and have been also teaching a lot of students and have an immense tutelage under them with the Gharana and passing on this intangible tradition and culture of music. Swagat karte hain aapka Pandit Rajan and Sajan Mishra ji.
Namaskar.
And we have Dr. S.B. Ota, who is basically known to all of us as the retired Joint Director General from Archaeological Survey of India. His archaeological pursuits have been quite exemplary, and all the people in our field know his writings and academic research very, very well. And presently, he's a Tagore National Fellow of Government of India to carry out his research on prehistory of Ladakh. Besides his services in ASI, Government of India also assigned him the additional responsibility as Director of Manav Sangrahalay, IGRMS, Bhopal. He was the first Director of National Mission on Monuments and Antiquities launched by Ministry of Culture, Government of India under the aegis of Archaeological Survey of India. Dr. Ota is the recipient of Young Scientist Award from Indian Science Congress Association in 1987 and was awarded Charles Wallace Indian Trust Fellowship in 1995. Was a short-term visiting fellow by Japan Foundation in 2006. During his career as part of Archaeological Survey of India, he has undertaken large number of archaeological investigation in the different areas of the country. Some of the main projects includes salvaging archaeological investigation of the submergence area of Narmada Valley Dam projects in Madhya Pradesh, prehistoric investigation in high altitude Ladakh Himalayas, and geographical archaeological investigation in Akulian sites in district Raisen, Madhya Pradesh. Besides archaeological investigation, he has undertaken large conservation works of a number of monuments, including several World Heritage Sites of ASI. And thus his deep link with Madhya Pradesh very much remains. So I welcome all of you. Welcome, Dr. Ota. And thank you for joining us already. So to start with, I will start with a set of questions which I have. I'm very curious about with your background and with your expertise. To start with, Sudhaji. Sudhaji, if you could please tell us about your involvement in Madhya Pradesh, especially I think projects like Bateshwar, with a deep passion of restoring cultural heritage to its former glory. Please.
Yeah. I have seen Madhya Pradesh many times in different forms because it's such a large state. You can't say in 10 days I can see Madhya Pradesh, all the places you can't cover if you love history. And in my case, it's very, very important subject to me. So I have seen in 4 or 5 times different sections of Madhya Pradesh. And once, I happened to know about Mr. Mohammed, who was an archaeological survey of India, and he was, I came to know him. Then I called him and said about Bateshwar, I want to know. And the details about Bateshwar, because those are the temples which are not known to the world that much, though they are so beautiful. People come to Gwalior and see other things, Gwalior Fort, all those things, but nobody thinks to go to Bateshwar, which is like a hidden jewel in the forest, I feel. And so is Mithawali and Padavali. When I talked to him, he said, okay, it's really true. And I invited him, I want to go to Gwalior and in search of Bateshwar temples. Will you come? And he came with me and we went Mithawali, Padavali, Shivpur, other places, but nothing like Bateshwar, which touched my heart. I thanked in a way those Chambal people, dacoits, because of them, I think it saved the temples. Otherwise, it would have been destroyed by many people and artifacts would have taken out. Nobody would have come there because they were scared of the dacoits in a way. But they are beautiful temples and it has to be completed. All are not actually done. Some of them have been done. So I told him that I'm ready to sponsor this temple, cluster of temple from Infosys Foundation. It will go up to 5 crore rupees. And I want, I don't have time, neither I have expertise. I'm not an expert. I'm one of the, person who is interested in this. So I want this job should be taken by Archaeological Survey of India because they know their job. And we'll do it in a phase by phase and we'll pay the money and we will have an MOU. So since a year we are following up and I really want, it has not yet been signed because this I want to tell the Madhya Pradesh government also, when people are ready to do, you should expedite this. So it is not yet moving forward because some other clearance goes on and people have less patience actually. See, in Karnataka, I took a temple which was 1400 years old and built in 4 dynasties in a place known as the Lakshmeshwara. And because I was from Karnataka, I directly went to the CM's office and I told, look, I don't want any money from you. We will support this entire project, but I want all your permission within a week's time. And we got it within a week's time. It took another 2.5 or 3 years. There's one of Mr. Venkateshaya is there. He was the director of the archaeology, who was from Karnataka. So I told under his guidance and with his team, we got it whole thing done. In 3 years, I think, we spent about 6 or 7 crores. We are ready to do such projects where, it requires public health, people who love arts, who love culture, who love history, we want to do. But I need this time, not time consuming, it time shortening methodologies. So Bateshwar is, we're about to sign, but we want it as early as possible. Within 2 or 3 years, you should complete. And I requested Mr. Mohammed. He said, of course, I will help you to come and look after that. Similarly, there are very beautiful temples in Madhya Pradesh. For example, there's one Kanakavati, the princess or the queen Kanakavati has built a very beautiful temple. It is about to fall in that region only. Or I feel Padavali and Mithawali should be connected to Gwalior. People should make 1 or 2 days visit and see all. They're exceptionally beautiful temples. This is what I have seen in Madhya Pradesh. It really requires a good participation of private people, corporate houses, individuals, and people are ready. People are ready, provided if you expedite or shorten the process of paperwork.
Thank you. Thank you, Sudhaji. This is really nicely put and everything. And that takes us to, since we are talking about stakeholders and private investment and everything, takes us to Mr. Borgia already. And if Mr. Borgia can just explain to us how he has been able to create this immersive travel experience, and also how did he bring all these stakeholders and community together, that would be great. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Like any other young person, I was also one who ran away from this country at 19, but at a cushy job with the UN, I realized, what am I doing in somebody's land? I always wanted to live like a Maharaja. I said a Maharaja has to be in his own land, otherwise he's in exile. So I took an early retirement from the UN and came back to India. My idea was to fight inequality. But when I came here, I saw the inequality. I've not seen people as rich as I've seen people in India, also the poor. The poor are in larger numbers. But my problem was the inequality among rural and the urban people. So when I came to the rural area, I found abundant wealth ignored. Hundreds of temples, hundreds of monuments, hundreds of heritage buildings. And I love heritage buildings. I love them so dearly. So I said, my God. So my focus kept changing. Finally, I settled down in saying, I will take care of these heritage buildings. And how? So two parallels. I thought I'll go to the government and government would welcome me with a red carpet to do this. But unfortunately, I'm fighting for the same reason for the last 40 years. So parallelly, a few of us got together and we said, we'll take over these heritage buildings from the government or from private people, buildings that are falling apart, and convert them into hotels. Neemrana is a classic example in north of India, you get me. Tejara is one. And now in the south, what I've done with the Mint Palace, and I went one step ahead. I said, let me do something composite. Instead of just taking the heritage building, let me go identify dilapidated villages where people have absconded. So I created my first hotel. I took over three dilapidated historical villages, which had so much of history, so much of wealth, literally wealth. Wherever I dig, I will find swords. I'll find pichwas of the Cholas, literally rich. So I said, I will take this. I converted these three villages into a, not five-star, into a mega-star village, superstar hotel. And today, there are 100 rooms in a remote village. 10 years ago, there was no electricity. Today, we have good Wi-Fi. I'm able to communicate with you. I'm sitting there. And we have good electricity. So it changed the whole village. So what a heritage monument can do to the entire surrounding is phenomenal. Today, this town, Kumbakonam, is the cleanest town in India, in spite of being the temple town. It's a town which has 57 air-conditioned bus stops. All girls' schools have a toilet. So many, many phenomenons like this. So it has become composite. So by building, taking care of a heritage hotel, the entire people come in, everything comes in. What the factor I have realized in this 40 years is, we should not expect the government to do anything. This is not the government's job. Parallelly, I ran too. I worked with the government for the last 40 years and I worked for myself. I have made my passion my business and it is a super paying business. I mean, why would a private guy like me run a museum? I'm not looking for funding from the government or from anybody. I own about three museums here, all for public. So this is what heritage conservation can do, provided if you're going the government route, government work, nothing moves. In the last 40 years, nothing has worked for me. I worked very closely with UNESCO. I worked very close with ASI. I'm close with culture ministry. No, nothing has worked. Except that I've seen secretaries change, DGs change, prime ministers change, everybody change. One factor that really worked with the government was during Jagmohan Kaur's time, Vajpayee government, what they've done in Vaishnava Devi. That could have been done anywhere in India. what Neem Rana has done can be done anywhere in India. Anything can be done anywhere but the will. So what I did privately for my business has worked wonders for me, and it is a very, very lucrative business. I made the past of this country my business. It's a future. I made India my product. I have no investment. So this way, we have moved phenomenally far, and I think we should take back heritage conservation back to the community. What happened in places like Hampi, what happened in places like Mahabalipuram are big time defaults. We unseated the local people, took away their worship rights and many things, but we gave it back. I think people who have protected our monuments for several centuries, they can continue to do, because I think ASI is too small to handle this mammoth responsibility. We need to look at opening up the doors to bring in a lot of private people who can do wonderful things. And let us go by our own example. Our own example, let us not import. Let's give heritage buildings to institutions. Let's give heritage buildings to corporates who want to lease that building, restore that building within parameters, and officiate from there. As far as these buildings are preserved, we should be a happy lot of people. We will not be regretting anything. Our monuments are so, so, so important. Thousands of them are even not being listed, not known. So I think we need to look at a totally new perspective of bringing in responsibility of the citizen to maintain, to identify, and to glorify these buildings. Then we don't need to keep counting for tourists. Tourists will flow in. The world will look at India with new eyes. After all, for several centuries, people came. Now they'll come in larger numbers. And one and two will preserve the beautiful heritage of our country. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Bhojia. This is very inspiring indeed. And I think all of us have to take an example. I think on the same similar lines, Pandit Rajanji or Pandit Sajanji bhi kuch kehna chahenge ki kis tarah private sector culture heritage conservation or incubation mein madad kar sakta hai. Pandit ji.
Namaskar. Sabhi logon ki baat sunke bahut inspiration mila hai. Aur jo hamara music hai, wo intangible heritage hai. Tangible heritage jo hai, wo kabhi banta hai, bigadta hai, lekin jo science aur raga hai, वो हजारों साल से ऐसी चला आ रहा है. तभी हम आज की दुनिया में मार्कोस का नाम सुन सकते हैं, भैरव का नाम सुन सकते हैं, श्री का नाम सुन सकते हैं और सुन भी सकते हैं गाने में. तो ये जो इंटेंजिबल हेरिटेज है हमारा म्यूजिक, इसको प्रिजर्व करने के लिए लोगों की मदद बहुत जरूरी है. समाज का मदद जरूरी है, सरकार का मदद जरूरी है, कॉरपोरेट सेक्टर का मदद जरूरी है. हमने तो कई बार अपने इंटरव्यूज में बोला था कि अगर कॉरपोरेट सेक्टर को कुछ इंसेंटिव दिया जाए और उनसे एक कॉर्पस फंड बनाया जाए और उसमें एक ट्रांसपेरेंसी लगा के एक ऐसे लोगों के हाथ में हो जिसमें कलाकार भी हो और आईएएस भी हो, बहुत ही ट्रांसपेरेंट तरीके से उस फंड का उपयोग हो, तो हमारा फोक म्यूजिक, हमारा क्लासिकल म्यूजिक, क्लासिकल डांस, सब कुछ सुरक्षित किया जा सकता है. क्योंकि अब आप देखिए, अभी ख्याल आया मेरे को कि अब जैसे कोहिनूर हीरा है, तो कोहिनूर हीरा तो चोरी किया जा सकता है, लेकिन क्लासिकल म्यूजिक को चोरी नहीं किया जा सकता है जब तक आप सीखेंगे नहीं और सीख के गुरु की चरण का आशीर्वाद नहीं लेंगे, तब तक वो पूरा आपके पास आएगा नहीं. तो ऐसे ही जो टेंजिबल हेरिटेज है उसको तो थोड़ा चुराया जा सकता है, लेकिन हमारा जो साइंस ऑफ राग है, हमारे राग में, हमारे सुरों में सीधा सीधा सन का प्रभाव है, सूर्य का प्रभाव है. जैसे भैरव राग है, तो उसमें भैरों का जो समय है वो हल्का हल्का आकाश में लाली छाई हुई है और धीरे धीरे सूरज निकल रहा है, तो उसी राग में ऋषभ और धैवत उस कैरेक्टर से लगता है और वही ऋषभ धैवत बाद में तोड़ी में लगता है तो उसका कैरेक्टर बदल जाता है। अब जैसे मैं एग्जांपल के लिए बताता हूँ, सा। अब यही ऋषभ अगर तोड़ी में लगाएंगे निसारे धनी सारे, स्ट्रेट ऋषभ लग रहा है, भैरों में आंदोलित ऋषभ लग रहा है, आंदोलित धैवत लग रहा है। तो ये हमारे संगीत का एक साइंस है और इस साइंस को प्रिजर्व किया जा सकता है, ट्रेडिशन को प्रिजर्व किया जाए, गुरु शिष्य परंपरा को प्रिजर्व किया जाए। और हमें ये कहते हुए बहुत ही अच्छा लग रहा है कि हम लोगों को करीब 55 ईयर्स हो गए स्टेज पे गाते हुए, और वो 55 साल की जो यात्रा है संगीत की उसको प्रिजर्व करने के लिए द लिविंग विथ म्यूजिक करके आर्काइव का काम हो रहा है। अब इसमें मैं चाहूंगा कि इसमें लोगों की भी मदद मिले, सरकार का भी मदद मिले, कॉरपोरेट सेक्टर CSR का भी मदद मिले, तो हम अपने धरोहर को बचा सकते हैं, ऐसा हमारा ख्याल है। और जो ग्वालियर है, जैसे बनारस को तो यूनेस्को ने
सिटी ऑफ म्यूजिक
सिटी ऑफ कल्चर डिक्लेयर किया है, वैसे ग्वालियर को भी करना चाहिए, क्योंकि ग्वालियर भी, ग्वालियर घराना बहुत पुराना घराना है और वहां भी बहुत बड़े बड़े आर्टिस्ट, बहुत बड़े बड़े संत हुए हैं, और उस शहर को, उसके हेरिटेज को प्रिजर्व करने की जरूरत है।
हेलो
जी, बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद पंडित जी। आई थिंक
निशान, जस्ट आई विल लाइक टू इंटरप्ट पंडित जी ने, चूंकि ये मुद्दा उठाया है ग्वालियर को हेरिटेज वाला, तो मैं हैप्पी टू शेयर, पंडित जी से मैं शेयर करने बड़ा खुशी महसूस कर रहा हूँ कि अंडर द यूनेस्कोज क्रिएटिव सिटी नेटवर्क हम लोग ग्वालियर को म्यूजिक के लिए हम लोग नॉमिनेट कर रहे हैं, उसकी हमारी तैयारी चल रही है, क्योंकि वो तानसेन की जगह है और वहाँ पर हमारा बहुत अच्छा म्यूजिकल जो घराने हैं, बहुत वो हमारे हेरिटेज प्रॉपर्टी है, तो ग्वालियर को यूनेस्को के तहत हम नॉमिनेट करने का प्रयास कर रहे हैं। साथ ही साथ भोपाल को यूनेस्को के क्रिएटिव सिटी नेटवर्क के अंतर्गत लिटरेचर में नॉमिनेट का प्रयास जारी है, चंदेरी को आर्ट और क्राफ्ट के लिए, और इंदौर को गैस्ट्रोनॉमी के लिए जारी है। तो ये एक हमारे लिए प्रदेश के लिए
बहुत, बहुत बड़ा कार्य है, आपको आपको बहुत बहुत साधुवाद।
जी बहुत बहुत थैंक यू सर, और थैंक यू पंडित जी, आपने बंदिश राग सुनाई और हम लोग को समझाया कि किस तरह इतने हल्के इनोटेशंस बदल कर भी कितना गहराई वाला अंतर आते हैं उस म्यूजिक में। और आई थिंक टू टेक दिस फॉरवर्ड, आई थिंक डॉक्टर ओटा, सिंस यू हैव अ वाइड एक्सपीरियंस विद इंस्टीट्यूशन एज वेल एज नाउ विद रिसर्च एज एन एकेडमिशियन, I think it will be great if you can kind of throw not only your light upon the your opinion of archaeological heritage of MP, but also how it connects to the living culture there. Please, thank you. Dr. Ota, आपका mic mute है, unmute कर दीजिए।
Thank you all. In fact, I have got a wider experience working with the government, whether it's a tourism department, whether it's anthropology, because I have got a background in anthropology. Of course, archaeology, I worked for 30 years. And most of our panelists, as they said, nothing moves. I fully agree, nothing moves. And we'll have to have a way out of that. That's what I feel now. Because we know whosoever is working in the government, they have got that certain constraints. Now that consensus is not with me, I can frankly speak. So I have got a different concept for the tourism industry. I'm not talking something about the highly specialized archaeology. I feel somewhere we have been lost in the tourism industry. How? We segregate all the sections, whether it's a geoheritage, whether it's a natural heritage, whether it's an architectural heritage or a living heritage or intangible heritage. What I feel with the background of anthropology and archaeology both, it has to be integrated. That is what really attracts the public to any place. I have worked for 30 years in different capacity, even for my research in Madhya Pradesh. Almost most of the corners I know, but the Madhya Pradesh, it's very rich. You name, whether it's a tangible, intangible, including geoheritage and natural heritage, that integrated things need to be developed. We have isolated everywhere throughout the country. The second thing is, all the panelists also said that there is a constraint of funds. I feel it has to be protection, management of the site's heritage has to be self-sustained. Why should we depend on government funding? And there are different ways and means we can really create. Like I can give you an example during my government days. I suggested, but that never no one takes care of it. You know, we can have, like for example, Mandu. We can have some sort of a heritage development authority. Money that we get, it should go back to that heritage conservation, local development. It should not come to the main exchequer. That is what even archaeological survey was fighting long back, never happened. And we have got the potential in our country. No need to take a single pie from the government. We can sustain. There are modalities. This next point is the local people, inhabitants, are never the beneficiaries because they are the people, those who protect the heritage. Why we're struggling? It is not my heritage as an ASI staff, it's the heritage of the local people. Now, if I give the benefits of that heritage to them, they'll be taken care of. And lastly, the objectives of the tourism should be take care of the heritage, whether it's a tangible and intangible. Now I'll give you just a few examples where, you know, in case of Madhya Pradesh, now we talk about the World Heritage. You know, those are dealing actually, you are dealing with the UNESCO. We can go for a serial nomination. All of us know that nomination is for only one in a year. We'll have to struggle. And we know that Mandu is lying for more than 25 years in the tentative list. So what we can do, all of us, we know, Rajasthan could declare 6 to 7 hill forts. We know how rich so far the forts of Madhya Pradesh are concerned. We should not go for a separate nomination. We can go for a serial nomination as an extension of the Rajasthan forts. So like that, there are many other things, even another shortcomings, I'm talking about the Madhya Pradesh in particular, we have never created a good circuit. The circuit, tourist circuit, as have been developed, some of the time we'll discuss, it's a really setback. I'll give a small example. Sanchi, how many people come to Sanchi to stay at Sanchi? None. Do you know, Sanchi area is one of the finest Buddhist circuit in the country. We have got as big as Sanchi is the Murel Khurd, as big as Sanchi is the Sardara and Sonari and Andhra. Such beautiful places within half an hour, 1 hour reach from Sanchi. Why we are not developing? Absolutely no connectivity, local connectivity that needs to be developed. None of the areas. Go to Mandu. Local connectivity. I'm not talking about from Indore or Dhar. Can I move from one monument to the other at Mandu? No, if I do not have a vehicle. Now, like that, why the failure is, one of the major shortcomings what I find is we do not have a good coordination committee. I'm not talking at the state level coordination committee. Mandu is a huge area. Khajuraho is a huge area. Why not do we have a coordination committee? There the government fails. Now, I don't know what the tourism is doing. I do not know what the revenue authority is doing. I do not know what the forest department is doing. Can't we have a coordination committee, create a development authority, create a funds? We can create the funds. We do. I know that we collect the funds from the tourists, every tourist, those who enter Mandu. Now, where that fund goes? No one knows. That goes to the panchayat. Why not we create a Mandu Development Authority Funds, Heritage Development Authority Funds, and money should go there. Like that, there are many suggestions. And one or more things. So, I mean, I sometimes feel tourism department in Madhya Pradesh can really earn a huge amount. ASI is all the time open for a beautiful. All of us, we have traveled a lot abroad. You go to any monument, get a beautiful souvenir. What souvenir we have created? Go to National Institute of Design. Pay your money, one-time money. Create beautiful souvenirs for all our ticketed monuments. That's not the ASI job. MP government can do it. Beautiful souvenirs, Andy, not the big ones. I know what sort of souvenirs we have. And a fast food. ASI keeps, I know that where is the drawback? That can, we can sit sometime and, resolve it. Now, not the hotels outside. Everyone feels, I can sit within the campus of, Khajuraho complex and have a fast food, have a cup of, sip a cup of tea or coffee and all that, looking at monuments. And there are small, small things can really be created. Not that's a hotel business is another thing. I'm talking monument centric and many things which is not, never comes under the purview of Archaeological Survey of India can be integrated if it comes from the government of Madhya Pradesh tourism sector. Tourism can lay hands, they can entangle the private sector. Like that, there are many things can really be done. Yeah.
Thank you, Dr. Ota. I think this is really solid points already we have here. And I think also the brilliant part about working in Madhya Pradesh is that the tourism department already have heritage conservation as part of their policy. Yes. And I think which is very rare is state tourism policy, because mostly they are concerned with the tourism output. And I think that is a very interesting part. And also, as you said, this fast food, and I think we can easily convert our local gastronomy and food. Yes. Because Indore has enough save and enough, and Bundelkhand has Bhata Ka Kariya, which can easily be given as fast food, actually, very well packaged and takeaway. Yes. Sort of vada pav sort of on that lines. And I think that could be very interesting, something to look into. If sir would like to say something, Mr. Shukla would like to add to this.
Nishant, thank you very much for giving me an opportunity to tell a couple of things which Mr. Ota and our esteemed panelists have raised. Very quickly, I'll just dwell upon them. Ek baat ye uthi thi ki heritage jo hamare properties hain, उनको हम corporates या दूसरे लोगों को PPP mode में कैसे involve करें, कुछ ज़्यादा से ज़्यादा लोग हमारे हाथ बढ़ाएं. Mr. Borgia also said that it is not only the government who can really do the job. Private sector will have to be roped in a big way. And so Government of India started very important scheme called Adopt a Heritage, where they have invited corporate, big corporates to adopt big monuments. And in Madhya Pradesh, Khajuraho ek group ne liya hai aur Gwalior Fort ek group ne liya hai. That's a piece of information, though other modalities are being worked out. And on the similar lines, state government has also now, we are coming out with our own policy equivalent of Adopt a Heritage, where we will invoke the private sector, corporates, as well as the diaspora. Anybody who is outside India, they love their motherland, anything, and they would like to contribute something for their motherland. So, hamara jo scheme ban raha hai state ki or se, Adopt a Heritage ke pattern pe, usme hum diaspora ka bhi involve karke, और उनका एक एक्टिव रोल रखना चाहेंगे कि कैसे हेरिटेज कंजर्वेशन में वो पार्टिसिपेट कर सके और अपना कंट्रीब्यूशन दे सके। दूसरी बात, ये बात आई है एएसआई के संदर्भ में और इवन स्टेट आर्कियोलॉजी के संदर्भ में भी, कि बहुत स्ट्रिंजेंट रूल्स और रेगुलेशन के कारण वो बाहर आगे बढ़ नहीं पाते हैं। तो मैं ये बताना चाहूंगा ओटा साहब की भी खुशी के लिए कि इस बार खजुराहो डांस फेस्टिवल में एक ऐसी यूनिक चीज हुई जो 45 साल से नहीं हुई थी। 45 साल से खजुराहो डांस फेस्टिवल मंदिर कॉम्प्लेक्स के बाहर होता था, जहां आर्टिफिशियली पीछे बैकड्रॉप क्रिएट किया जाता था मंदिर। इस बार 45 साल के बाद डीजीएसआई बिकेम ही केम टू टर्म्स विद द रियलिटी एंड उन्होंने परमिट किया मंदिर कॉम्प्लेक्स के अंदर खजुराहो डांस फेस्टिवल हुआ इस बार February 21, जो कि एक बहुत बड़ी चीज थी, जो कि एक ओपनिंग अप की ओर इशारा करती है। तीसरी बात मैं ये कहना चाहूंगा, जो आपने कहा बहुत माकूल बात कही, कि कोई भी डेस्टिनेशन जो हेरिटेज के पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू से इंपॉर्टेंट है, जैसे आपने सांची का एग्जांपल दिया, यदि हम वहां पे दूसरे एलिमेंट्स को साथ में कंबाइन नहीं करेंगे, वहां पर हम केवल हेरिटेज को सेल नहीं कर पाएंगे, वहां हमें कल्चर को डालना पड़ेगा, वहां हमें नेचर, वहां पे हमें टूरिज्म के और दूसरे इनपुट्स, एडवेंचर टूरिज्म, इस प्रकार से पैकेज डील हमें देनी पड़ेगी ताकि लोग वहां पर आए और वहां रुके। आपने बिल्कुल सही कहा, सांची में कोई नहीं रुकता, बट वील हैव टू मेक सांची सच एन अट्रैक्टिव डेस्टिनेशन वेयर ऑल द मेंबर्स ऑफ द फैमिली ऑफ एनी एज दे हैव समथिंग अदर अदर टू लुक फॉरवर्ड टू। ये बात मैं कहना चाहता था। चौथी बात मैं कहना चाह रहा हूं कि आपने ये कहा जो लोकल इकोनॉमी जनरेट होती है, जो फंड्स जनरेट होते हैं, बिल्कुल सही कहा आपने, और मध्य प्रदेश ने इसमें स्टेप ले लिया है और हमने एक हेरिटेज डेवलपमेंट ट्रस्ट बनाया है, जहां पर हमें सारा पैसा जो आता है मॉन्यूमेंट से कलेक्ट होकर के टूरिज्म का, वो हम वहां पे इकट्ठा करते हैं। नाउ वी आर ट्राइंग टू फ्रेम रूल्स कि हम इसमें से जिसका शेयर जितना है उसको वहां जाए, सो दैट दे डोंट डिपेंड ऑन द गवर्नमेंट फॉर एवरी टाइम टू टेक अप कंजर्वेशन वर्क्स और डेवलपमेंट वर्क्स। एक बात आपने बहुत अच्छी कही, लोकल इन्वॉल्वमेंट होना बहुत जरूरी है, कोऑर्डिनेशन लोकल लेवल पर होना बहुत जरूरी है। इसके लिए हम लोगों ने डिस्ट्रिक्ट लेवल पे डिस्ट्रिक्ट आर्कियोलॉजिकल टूरिज्म एंड कल्चर कमेटी, इसमें सभी इनपुट्स को डाल दिया है, DATCC बनाया है कलेक्टर की अध्यक्षता में, जिसका काम यही होगा कि वो कोऑर्डिनेट करेगा, चाहे वो सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट की एजेंसी हो चाहे लोकल एजेंसीज हो, उनके बीच में कोऑर्डिनेट करके वहां पे अच्छे से काम करेगा। तो ये आपके सुझाव बहुत अच्छे थे और पंडित जी ने भी जो सुझाव दिए बहुत अच्छे थे, और मैं बहुत इंप्रेस्ड हूँ मिस्टर भोजिया से, जिन्होंने सुझाव देना बड़ा आसान होता है, कहना बड़ा आसान होता है, वो करके दिखा रहे हैं। वी एक्चुअली नीड टू लर्न फ्रॉम पीपल लाइक यू मिस्टर स्टीव, वेयर वी वुड लाइक टू लर्न मोर हाउ टू रियली ओपन अप एंड इन्वॉल्व द प्राइवेट सेक्टर इन अ बिग वे इन अवर हेरिटेज कंजर्वेशन। थैंक यू।
थैंक यू, थैंक यू फॉर टेकिंग दिस अप एज़ वेल। एंड जस्ट टू फॉलो द सेम ट्रेल ऑफ थॉट वेयर डॉक्टर ओटा आल्सो मेंशन्ड सीरियल नॉमिनेशन एंड सर्किट्स, I think it will be interesting if Sudha ji could talk about her experiences with the cultural landscape trails and cultural routes and journeys, which she really, really enjoys in Madhya Pradesh, I have a feeling, along with Narmada and henceforth. Please, Sudha ji. Sudha ji, it's on mute, the mic.
It is indeed a great pleasure to listen to all the people who are so much experienced and there are many ways you should attract people. That is a very important thing. The people will be attracted if they know about it. This is the way I have seen. I read and I go, but everyone will not have that much time. So you require to make some trail which are important to some kind of people. You make A, B, C, D different trails so that, depending on your taste, you can take it. For example, if you make a Narmada trail, it is Amarkantak, then Narmada flows and she goes, and at the end she goes to Gujarat, and then she joins Gulf of Kambata, actually. That's the place I remember. So, there are many times I have done this trail myself in England, starting from the origin of Thames. And I just went along the Thames, some villages, some cities. At the end, I came to London, and then she joined the sea, whatever the sea is called. Narmada is also, religiously, we always believe that if you take a dip at Narmada, when she joins, Kshipra joins Narmada, if I'm not mistaken. That Sangam, if you take a dip, Sarva Papa Niharini, this is called. And this kind of a trail are very useful. You make a Buddhism tour, you trail, you make handcraft, or you make fort. You have so many trails or natural national parks. So I feel Narmada Trail will attract a lot of people who are culturally connected, religiously connected. At least you can do what, wherever she flows up to in Madhya Pradesh. Kshipra is another thing which people who love Kalidasa will really enjoy, because Kshipra appears in so many of Kalidasa's plays, Meghasuta, and also in Bhartruharis, in many ways. So Kshipra is another tour you can make. I would love to do Kshipra because it's not even large, long, you know, it's 40 kilometers or something like that kind, or even more than that. So if you really work on what people want and you make trails depending on that, like Dharmic people would like to see Omkareshwar and Mahakaleshwar because they are the only two Jyotirlingas in Madhya Pradesh. And Mahakaleshwar has a lot more historical reason because, you know, I met a great mathematician, Manjul Bhargava, who is known as the Ramanujam in the today's living mathematical world. He says, you know, why he's not Mahakala, why he called Mahakala? He was Greenwich of India, 0.0. So India's Greenwich was Ujjain, and in Ujjain, it was the Mahakala's place where the time was set 0.0, what you call today Greenwich in UK. So people who are religious, they can also, people who are interested in history, you have to do this one. And I have an earnest request to the government of Madhya Pradesh. You really want to impress or bring interest in your children, in that case, you should teach history in a school level about your own MP state in a very nice way. So when they grow up, they can take the thread and they can continue. So I feel Madhya Pradesh tourism should take care of, talk to people and find out the different trails which they are interested. And then you can continue with that.
Thank you, Siddhaji. Actually, this is really, I think, the trail, the whole idea of trail and everything is very interesting, because there are several parikrama and yatras which are already existing in our mythology. We already do it. I think it'll be just a little bit of push, and we have already enabled a whole beautiful system in place, and we have rediscovered our own cultural value and traditions, and also bring newer, younger generation into it, where they want to go walking to Santiago de Compostela, why don't they walk Narmada? I think it would be really, really interesting as well. And I would invite all the attendees to put some question and answers, because I think we already have content and we'll have some time later also. To continue further, I would like Panditji to, if they can first of all give their opinion, what is this role of exchange, this international exchange in music as a creative sector, and this UNESCO Creative City Network and henceforth. And as a very humble personal request, if we can also hear some lines on these trails, these folk songs which are sung about rivers, about their beauty, that will be really amazing. Thank you. Thank you, Bhante.
Madhya Pradesh mein toh bahut sare हेरिटेज क्षेत्र है जिसमें वाइल्ड लाइफ भी है, कान्हा बांधोगढ़, ये इसका भी डेवलपमेंट होना चाहिए। और जो हम लोगों को वर्ल्ड में परफॉर्मेंस करके जो हमें एक्सपीरियंस मिला है, तो वो एक्सपीरियंस ये मिला है कि विदेश में हमारे शब्दों को तो नहीं समझते लोग, हमारे बंदिशों को नहीं समझते, लेकिन हमारे सुर को जरूर समझते हैं। इसलिए म्यूजिक इज ए यूनिवर्सल लैंग्वेज, ऐसे कहा गया है। और हमें तो ऐसे एक्सपीरियंस हुए हैं कि फ्रांस में और मोनोब्लॉक, बहुत छोटी छोटी जगह, नीस, इन सब जगहों पे हमारा संगीत सुन के लोग बहुत आंख में आंसू लेके सीडी पे साइन लेने आए। हम लोग का एक वर्ल्ड टूर हुआ था 2018 में, तो उसमें हमने 55 कॉन्सर्ट गाए थे और 13 कंट्री, जिसमें आर्कियोलॉजिकल जो पार्क है अंकोर वाट, तो वी वेयर द फर्स्ट इंडियन टू परफॉर्म देयर इन द पार्क इन द हेरिटेज साइट। तो वो जो अनुभव हुआ है उससे अनुभव में यही आया है कि संगीत जुबान की बात नहीं है, दिल की बात है। संगीत समझने के लिए हृदय चाहिए, और हृदय जिसका अच्छा होगा वो कोई भी संगीत समझ सकता है। अब जैसे हम लोग को वेस्टर्न क्लासिकल भी बहुत पसंद है, हम घर में सुनते रहते हैं, हमें उनके न्यूएंसेस नहीं पता है, लेकिन कानों को अच्छा लगता है, बहुत सुनते हैं। बीथोवन, बाख, मोजार्ट, हाइडन, सबको सुनते रहते हैं। तो वो जो संगीत की एक धारा है, एक जो उसका एस्थेटिक है, वो सबको पसंद आता है। ईश्वर की वाणी है ये। एक मुझे बंदी से याद आ गया, तानसेन जी की ध्रुपद की बंदिश है। तो हम और साजन भाई दोनों गा रहे हैं, प्रथम ज्योति ज्वाला,
प्रथम ज्योति ज्वाला, शरण तेरी मां, प्रथम ज्योति ज्वाला, प्रथम ज्योति ज्वाला, ज्ञान बा प्रसन्न भई, ऋषि सिद्धि देनी, ज्ञान बा प्रसन्न भई, ऋषि सिद्धि देनी, तान सेन अर्पुति करे राखु लाज मे मां, प्रथम
ये राग दरबारी की बंदिश है। तो ये हम लोग बहुत गाते हैं, और सभी घरानों की अच्छी अच्छी बंदिशें हम गाते हैं। हम किसी एक घराने में संकुचित होके नहीं रहना चाहते, सब जगह अच्छे फूल हैं, सबका खुरफूल हो।
रागों से आप निरोगी भी हो सकते हैं, जैसा कि अभी कानपुर IIT ने रिसर्च किया है, राग भीमपलासी, राग दरबारी से आपका ब्लड प्रेशर कंट्रोल हो सकता है। तो ऐसे बहुत सारे राग हैं, और पुराने युग में उस समय ऐसा कहा जाता था कि मंत्रों के साथ संगीत सस्वर उनके कान में डाला जाता था तो व्यक्ति निरोग हो जाता था। तो हमारे यहाँ इस चीज को बहुत मान्यता है, और हम उस पर बिलीव भी करते हैं, क्योंकि हमारे यहाँ ये हेरिटेज परंपरा करीब 400 साल से हमारे घर में भी है। तो हम उस चीज को लेके आगे बढ़ रहे हैं, हमारे बच्चे लोग भी कर रहे हैं, सैकड़ों शागिर्द कर रहे हैं। उम्मीद है कि हम अपने भरसक प्रयास में सफल रहेंगे। वैसे आप सभी के सहयोग की आवश्यकता निश्चित रूप से रहती है, आप सब सहयोग करें संगीत के लिए। संगीत के लिए कोई भी ध्यान नहीं दिया जा रहा, एकमात्र मध्य प्रदेश सरकार है जो कि 11-12 अवार्ड देती है साल में, और कोई भी स्टेट ऐसा नहीं है जो कि एक संगीतकार को इस तरीके से सम्मानित करता हो। और जितना मध्य प्रदेश सरकार कल्चरल हेरिटेज के लिए जो कार्य करती है, हमने पूरे हिंदुस्तान में तो नहीं देखा कि कोई स्टेट इतना ज्यादा इन्वॉल्व हो। तो इसके लिए मैं मध्य प्रदेश सरकार को बहुत बहुत बधाई देना चाहता हूँ, और वो ऐसे ही सदैव इन हेरिटेज को बचाने के लिए प्रयासरत रहे। मैं यही ईश्वर से कामना करता हूं कि उनको हमेशा सफल रहे।
मैं दो शब्द अर्ज कर सकता हूं निशांत पर, वीडियो पंडित जी। पंडित जी बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद, मध्य प्रदेश को आपने ये बात आपने सबके सामने उठाई। 25 से ऊपर अवार्ड्स कल्चर डिपार्टमेंट देता है प्रतिवर्ष। जी हाँ, बहुत नामी ग्रामी अवार्ड्स होते हैं, बहुत ही प्रेस्टिजियस अवार्ड्स होते हैं। साथ ही साथ मैं बताना चाहूंगा कि हमारे यहाँ का आर्कियोलॉजी डिपार्टमेंट भी वाकनकर जी की स्मृति में अवार्ड देता है, नेशनल अवार्ड देता है। और नोटेड जो आर्कियोलॉजिस्ट हैं जिन्होंने बहुत कंट्रीब्यूट किया है प्रदेश के आर्कियोलॉजी को बढ़ावा देने के लिए और देश के आर्कियोलॉजी को, उनको चयनित किया जाता है, और बहुत ही अच्छा माहौल में वो काम होता है। और वाकनकर जी के नाम पर जिन्होंने भीमबेटका की डिस्कवरी की, जो वहाँ पे रॉक आर्ट्स जो आज वर्ल्ड हेरिटेज साइट है, उनके नाम पे हमने एक रिसर्च इंस्टीट्यूट बनाया। और मैं आपसे ये भी शेयर करना चाहूंगा कि रॉक आर्ट भी एक ऐसी चीज है, रॉक शेल्टर्स, जो मध्य प्रदेश की यूनिक प्रपोजिशन है। भीमबेटका तो हम सब जानते हैं क्योंकि वर्ल्ड हेरिटेज साइट डिक्लेयर हो गया है, बट पचमढ़ी सतपुड़ा नेशनल पार्क और गांधी सागर की तरफ चतुर्भुज नाला, वहां पर ये रॉक आर्ट हमारी बिखरी हुई है. सो वी आर सो ब्लेस्ड इन द स्टेट. वो भी हम एक प्रयास कर रहे हैं कि हम एक प्रदेश में एक कहीं ना कहीं एक प्री हिस्टोरिक पार्क हम क्रिएट करें, जहां पर मॉडर्न तरीकों से और ऑडियो विजुअल और जितने भी मैकेनिज्म्स जो टेक्नोलॉजी हो सकती है, लोगों को एक इमर्सिव एक्सपीरियंस कराएं उसी समय पे एरा में ले जा करके रॉक आर्ट के बारे में, और प्री हिस्टोरिक पेंटिंग्स जो हमारे पास अभी भी अच्छे हालत में है उनको प्रिजर्व भी करें और लोगों के सामने प्रदर्शित करें. तो ये भी हम लोग कुछ प्रयास करें.
बहुत बड़ी बात, बहुत अच्छी बात है.
बहुत बहुत थैंक यू. आई थिंक एक और अनदर क्वेश्चन. थैंक यू पंडित जी, और बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद, आपने सुनाकर भी बताया हमें रात. एक देयर इज अनदर क्वेश्चन व्हिच आई थिंक देयर इज व्हिच स्टेज स्टिल देयर एंड गोस directly from the inferences from Panditji, is that Mr. Borgia, how do you incubate local culture of this village in your projects? How do you make it a part of, how is this immersive tourism working, please?
Main kuch bolu. Hum log ek center bana rahe hain Gujarat mein Living with Music ka. तो उसमें जो लोकल बच्चे हैं उनको सिखाएंगे और वर्ल्ड ओवर सब जगह से लोग आएंगे और उनको तालीम दिया जाएगा. ये हम अपने तरीके से प्रयास कर रहे हैं, अपने संसाधन से. तो आप हमें आशीर्वाद दीजिए कि हम अपने काम में सफल हों.
हम सबकी शुभकामनाएं इसके साथ. प्लीज मिस्टर बोर्जिया, प्लीज इफ यू कैन एलाबोरेट.
या इट्स अ लवली क्वेश्चन. But you will be surprised when you go into rural pockets, when you go into cultural belts and involve the local community, you will see what potential they have and you will see how beautifully they want to integrate the whole thing because it affects their life. They love those buildings. They love our heritage. They love our culture so much, they integrate itself. So in return, I made sure it became their profession. For instance, I moved a 1737 building from Chennai. The government decided to break it because they wanted to make place for the new secretariat, a modern New York kind of a building. I took them to court. I took them to Supreme Court. I lost. Finally, when they broke, I stopped it. I bought that building, 1737. I bought the building, removed it stone by stone. In 42 lorries, I carried it to nearly 380 kilometers because I didn't have place anywhere to store the stone. With the help of local people, not even local architects, I managed to build back the four floors precise, not one check. It does not have brick and mortar, no stones, no cement. It is just on friction. I don't know. It was, they knew it by instinct, like the way we make babies. They built me the four floors. So they have it there. The moment the local communities can genuinely benefit something, all through, you have their sake. Then slowly, for me, it was to build my hotel with heritage. But slowly, everything came in. They came to cook into the kitchen. They gave me food that used to be produced 100 years ago. New names I heard, like Lapa, this, that. I heard new songs being sung in the hotel by local old ladies. I saw new technologies of producing building material. Did you know they made their tiles with the Thai? Just put clay, tap it on the Thai, and they made these curved tiles. Beautiful. So it is all interlocked, from culture to behavior to ecology, the health science. There was once Mr. Mitterrand's brother, the French premier's brother, came here with his wife. She fell down and sprained her leg. A local man set her leg right in less than 30 minutes flat, and she couldn't believe it. And you know how much she tipped him? 1 lakh rupee. So this is what exists around our culture. How can we use it? And this is nothing new. What worries me is, why are we refraining from doing few things which are already being done? If that fort in Tejera is not given to Neem Rana group, we wouldn't have had that beautiful restoration, Neem Rana, our hotel here. Similarly, look at, I mean, why can't we hand over a falling building if a corporate wants, let me hire this building, let me lease this building from you, restore it, and I will run my office inside that building. I did that in Mahabalipuram. Why can't we do that? Give it to music schools. If you don't want to give it to the corporate, if you think the corporate is stealing your heritage, give it to music schools. Give it to schools for as children in special needs. There are thousands of things that we can do and also make it a heritage monument. So this is the way I look at it. I think the government has to just decide to let it go and make it survive. This is not the business of the government to restore buildings, to maintain these buildings. And I'm sure ASI cannot do because they have very few staff and very little money. They don't have to go and beg the corporate, beg this person to get the funds. Half of them are fund staff. So just let it go. Make sure they follow the parameters and everything happens at the right time. And I think that's the route we should take. And everything will automatically happen. If somebody hates heritage, he will not even come near that. People who come near these contributions are people who love, people who are passionate. Luckily, you know where my guilt is? I preserve, conserve, I'm very ecological, I'm regenerative, and my business makes a lot of money. And I'm enjoying it alone with the local communities. There are no beggars around my hotel. All children have toilets, a whole lot of things we are able to contribute. Why can't everybody do that? They are willing to do, but so much of principles, policies, the subcommittees will not take you anywhere. Leave it to a private group and you control. You say, these are the parameters. If I can lease a piece of land or a building from Tamil Nadu government and I create a hotel, I run it, and I hand it over to them after 30 years in good condition, I think any government can do. Anybody can do. And use it for good purpose. You want to give it to a music school? You want to give it to a dance school? You want to give it to a cultural purpose? A school for special children? Do anything as far as that building is used and saved. In a beautiful building called the Victoria Memorial in Madras, next to the Central Railway Station, we are running Football Association, the Hockey Association of India is operating out of that. In the Tanjore Palace, we are running lorry service, retreading for tires. I mean, this is nonsense. But why are we not able to stop it? Why are we not able to put, I mean, in a heritage building, you hear music, the building value goes up. You hear the tone of dance, the building value goes up. All this can be done. But there is a conflict, permanent conflict between the state government and the central government. I think these are things that should be resolved. Then everything will fall in place and give it away to private people who are passionate, to dignified musicians, to dancers, to run. They will pay you a rent, but that building will be maintained. I think so.
Thanks a lot.
I'm sorry if I'm very vociferous because it is 30 to 40 years of pangs that make me talk. And now I did everything as my business and it is beautiful.
I'm glad you share your experience. I think we need this kind of experience sharing, and that is how we learn and we'll move ahead as well. I think one of the relevant questions which came to us also was from Prachi Chaturvedi. And I think if Sudhaji can answer that, what steps can be taken to prevent decrease in tourism, especially because of issues like security of tourists, especially women, and cleanliness and maintenance of monuments. We heard that you did some interesting thing in Mayuras of Karnataka. If you can just elaborate on that, please.
Actually, the main problem in India, whether it's in MP or in Karnataka, is when women travel, we require good street lights, then good toilets and security. Otherwise, it's hard to travel. So in such places, we have built toilets, but we don't maintain it. We tell the local gram panchayat or the authority there, you charge and you maintain it. We don't want to take that responsibility because our foundation, we have only 7-8 people. So we build the facility, but we don't own it, nor we take any benefit from that. Because if we have renovated this beautiful temple of Someshwara in Lakun, in Puligere or Lakshmeshwar, we spent 7 crore rupees on that. But there is no entrance fee. It is not for commercial purpose. It is because we love arts, and every art belongs to that nation, that area. So we don't charge, and we don't have any financial transaction once we do the work. We tell the Gram Panchayat, look, we have done this work. Knowledge should be free. Anybody can come. He can sit there. And we perform 3 days music festival. No charge. And similarly, we'll build toilets. You charge. And you take the money. You maintain. So unless our toilets are well maintained, unless the street lights are very good, unless the road connectivity is very good, it is difficult to expect. At least what I know in Karnataka, I'm telling you, tourists should come in unknown places. A place like Bangalore, it is okay. But a place like Lakshmeshwara, people won't come. A place like Gwalior is fine. A place like Bateshwar or Mithavali or Padavali, people don't come. First of all, they don't have the knowledge. Second thing, they should have definitely a good toilet facility. And it is left to the, you know, whosoever you give the monument, because it is not easy to take a monument and maintain it. It is not easy. We have done 2-3 such monuments. So we always say the people of that village or people of that area, they should participate. We will build it one time. They should continue to maintain it. On that basis only we work. And I request you, Madhya Pradesh Tourism Department, people, that you see that, you know, some portion you should do, some portion someone should do. But, you know, corporate houses will not take interest unless it is well known, unless you allow them to put the board. Some people don't like to put the board. In my case, I don't want the board. For me, board is not important. For me, the monument is important. But everybody has a different idea. So unless you make it easy to access the government norms, unless you make us to, you know, invite us, or you make the roads better or something, we will not be able to do. This is my limited knowledge. I have felt it. Unless government cooperates, I don't say they should give money. I never say they should give money, but they should cooperate with us to sanction. I can't touch any monument today. No monument I can touch because they belong to the government. This is what is my opinion.
Thank you. Thank you. We have another 2 questions by Rishabh Sharma and Samiksha Badoria, which are kind of intertwined. I think they are trying to ask that what are the efforts taken by MP Tourism to, first of all, make the tribal culture and folk culture attractive for the youth, and how to involve the local tribes and have very inclusive policy. Sir, if you could please answer.
Well, I think my AMD Sonia Meena has also joined in. If she's there, I think I leave it to her to respond to this particular question. Yeah. Sonia, are you there?
A very good afternoon to everyone. Nishanji, could you please repeat the question once more?
So basically, the essence of the question is that what are the first of all, if I can kind of introduce, she would be Miss Sonia Meena, and additional managing director of Madhya Pradesh Tourism Board. And she has done extensive work in the board since she has joined, and we have brilliant experience with working with her so far, definitely. And
thank you.
So the question is basically what steps, efforts MP Tourism has taken so far making the folk and the tribal culture attractive towards the youth, and also the policy to be more inclusive of the local tribes and people.
Right. So I think that is a very relevant and pertinent question, especially in the view of some of the projects that we are undertaking in the Tourism Board. We all know that Madhya Pradesh is home to a very rich treasure of tribal and rural culture. we have about 21% of our population which is tribal, and about 70%, more than 70% of our population lives in rural areas. And hence, this gives us a wonderful opportunity to showcase our cultural heritage and package it, market it as a tourism product. Because these days we see that in the tourism sector also, the trend is towards experiencing authentic and local culture, cuisine, lifestyles, etc. We have a lot of people from urban areas who have never been in touch, never known how a lot of people in rural areas live. And we have an increasing clientele of young people, even children, families who are visiting villages to know more about the rural culture and lifestyle. To this effect, what we are working on is our rural tourism project, under which we have already identified about 60 villages, and we will be identifying 100 villages in all. Maybe this year we are going to finish that target. And here we are mobilizing the community. We are assisting the community through financial incentives and various kinds of skill trainings and orientation exercises, where they will be constructing homestays in their own houses where the tourists can come. They will also have several hands-on experiences in the farms, in the in and around the forests that are surrounding the villages, to get an experience of not just the natural resources and heritage of that area, but also to experience the lifestyle, the cuisine, the folk arts and music of that particular area. Madhya Pradesh can basically be divided into six cultural zones. Therefore, we have a very interesting availability, plethora of cultural experiences that can also be given to the tourists. It's very diverse, whether you come to the Chambal area, whether it's Bundelkhand, Mahakaushal, the Malwa area, there are there's so much diversity in the experiences that can be offered. So that is something that we are working on currently.
Just to add what Sonia has said, I would just like to tell you, Nishant, that we are also trying to start a tribal trail, kind of tourism circuit dedicated towards, taking people to the tribal villages of different nature. There is a lot of diversity among the tribals also. And we are blessed with a lot of diversity among tribals, and we'd like to bring people and tourists closer to different tribal communities and their cultures and customs. So we are also working on that area, as Sudhaji also mentioned, that we need to work upon different kind of trails which are suited to different kind of interest groups. So tribal trail is another thing which is in the offing.
Thank you so much. I think Dr. Ota would like to add to it a little bit. So if he can quickly add, and then I'll try to summarize, because we are, I think, almost.
Yeah. About this particular, the tribal heritage, which how that can be really introduced. I'll give a small example so that you'll be knowing. For example, the new concept which is coming out is very easy. Don't bring the tribals to our city to enjoy their festivals and all that. Nowadays, in many of the states, what they are doing, for example, Bhil festival. So you identify a core Bhil village, and the festival will be performed in that village, and it will be announced by the tourism department. Okay, this is the festival, you go there and enjoy it. And I will never prescribe that people should stay there. Then there is another problem. Then second thing is, there is a community museum. I'm somehow against the IGRMS, that's one thing. There should be a museum among the bills, by the bills, within the village, created by the, you just support them. So if I want to know the bills, I'll go to their, not modern building, their own creation building, and exhibited by the bills. All the festivals will be announced, you go there. That is one way of looking at. And the other one is like Mandu and other places. In many places they are doing it. You bring these educated tribals with their own traditional dress. They can really work in our hotels, motels, and all that. They can become a part of our tourism complex. The local people will be benefited, and to hardly, you know, 7th, 8th standard and all that, we can train them. They can get into the hotel industry and other things in the local, not in the cities, in that same, which is really matches jails with that. Thank you.
Thank you. No, I think also this is really, just to share a happy example on the same lines, we worked together with another organization in Ladakh. In Skurbuchan, there is this small town near Kargil, and we basically just motivated the local monks, the local monastery, to start collecting ancient cookware. So they collected cookware made of stone, like huge bhagonas and huge things, and made of wood and stone. And they created a museum within the ancient kitchen of the monastery. And now it's a very well visited. So the only thing what we did was we gave them a framework, how to catalog things, how to put them in an order, a little bit of interpretation. And it was just on-site experience of a kitchenware in ancient kitchen in Skurbuchan. I mean, it's a brilliant experience in itself. So I think on those lines, if I could conclude as well, and thanks a lot to all the people who gave the recommendations on the chat box as well, and reading them and understanding them, what I could understand out of it is that I think we need to rediscover and reinvent and perhaps even contemporize the cultural heritage assets of Madhya Pradesh to not only make it a product for the user or the tourist, but also to make it a source of livelihood for the local community. And I think if we are able to strike that balance, it'll be already something. Please, sir.
Nishan, before you really thank everyone and wind up the session, I would like to just, by way of a suggestion, that today's esteemed panel, if they all agree, I would like to keep you to in a kind of advisory board to keep us guiding and motivating us towards taking heritage conservation to the next level. And also, I would request people like you to become brand ambassadors of Madhya Pradesh tourism. Like Ms. Sudha Murthy could be one of the persons for, she could be a great inspiration for such kind of not-for-profit organizations to bring them together under one umbrella for MP tourism. And Mr. Rajan Sajan Mishra could, garner a lot of support among the cultural pundits. And Mr. Borgia could be one of our very important brand ambassadors among the hoteliers to bring them to terms with the new realities, and also to bridge up the gap between the heritage conservation and the commerce. And similarly, Mr. Ota, with his very valuable suggestions, if you could be on board with us. I would like to request all of you to become our brand ambassadors. If you give, we will also formally write to you. If you give your consent, we'd like to engage with you.
Yeah, it will be a great pleasure, because nothing like culture, you know, and I really enjoy it. Whatever way I could give my experience and guide, I will be very happy to do that. Dhanyavad for that.
So Nishan, before you wind up, I just wanted to say just a couple of things. One, Shiva has already mentioned about the Adopt a Heritage project scheme that the ministry has. And it's, and I must say at this point that everyone is echoing the same things, that not only is not the business of the government, not only is it beyond the government, but I would also say the culture and heritage of a land does not only belong to the government. So it is for all of us to come together and to adopt a heritage. And I know that Infosys has actually been trying to work with us, that it is for corporates, it's for private individuals, it is for PSUs, it is for anybody and everybody to come forth and start working for the preservation of their country. And as Mr. Bojia's example shows, it is not just that you're doing charity work through that, you're actually making your own livelihood through that. So it's, I think that is a very important narrative that has come out. And I totally support Shio's suggestion that the excellent people on our panel today should truly become the brand ambassadors, because it's people like you who are making the difference. And we definitely need you to be our partners in journey with us as we take our incredible India forward.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Brar. And I think on behalf of all the panelists, I will, if I may, I would like to thank MP Tourism Board for having us here and really giving us an opportunity to be able to express our opinion and the views as well. And to sum up, I would like to invite Ms. Sonia Meena to give us a vote of thanks. And thank you.
Now, before that, will you send me the list of the people and their emails and telephone numbers so that I will contact them for different issues separately? Like Ms. Rota, I want to speak to him. Many more things. And with Rupinder, I want to speak something else, you know. Sajan ji, and, you know, I want to talk. So please connect me. I want to talk to them.
Definitely. We'll do that.
Thank you.
Thanks, Nishant. I would like to thank all our panelists for so graciously consenting to be a part of today's webinar. The objective of holding this webinar was to bring to our audience, which consists of members of the travel trade, students from hospitality and architecture institutes, officials of the government, and several discerning individuals and agencies who work or are interested in the field of heritage, a complete and nuanced picture of heritage research and conservation scenario in the country today. The presence of our esteemed speakers, Mrs. Sudha Murthy, Pandit Rajan and Sajan Mishra ji, Dr. Ota, and Mr. Steve Borgia has, I'm sure, helped in enriching the understanding with respect to heritage and at the same time provided a rare musical treat to all our viewers. I hope we will continue to receive your valuable insights in our initiatives in the future also. I would like to thank Mr. Nishant Upadhyay for moderating the session so effortlessly and bringing out all perspectives to make this webinar a fruitful exercise. We are grateful to ADG, Ministry of Tourism, Rupinder Brar ma'am, for always supporting and encouraging the efforts of the Madhya Pradesh Tourism Department. We are grateful to our Principal Secretary, Mr. Shiv Shekhar Shukla, for giving us this task of organizing a national level seminar with the best of experts from different fields working on heritage, which will help bring the topic into mainstream discussion and generate awareness. I would like to thank all our participants who have taken the time out on a Sunday morning to join us for this webinar. And in the end, let me thank my whole team of the Madhya Pradesh Tourism Board for putting together this event today, coordinating with all the speakers, working on the technical logistics, and ensuring wide promotion and publicity for this webinar. Thank you all.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks to the organizers.
Thank you.